us here today. First off, I'd like to introduce ourselves as Coco Consulting as we give this presentation from a viewpoint in 2014. My name is Alex Jing. On my left is Cody Pollan, Hal McCormick, and John Cronin. And we are spreading the risk across Ferrero supply chain. So just a brief agenda. I know this is your third presentation already, so we'll just touch upon the background briefly, follow that with the problem statement. Next, Cody will get into our decision matrix with recommendation. After that, Cal will get into our detailed analysis of our recommendation. And then John and I will bring it home with our rollout plan and further consideration. So in 2014, Turkey suffered cold weather conditions and blistering mornings, just like this one we have today, which devastated Turkey's hazelnut crop. Now, this is important because 75% of the world's hazelnut crop comes from Turkey. Now, this may not seem like a big deal for most of us, but to chocolate confectioners like Ferrero, they must worry about it a lot. And as they have been increasing their sales over the past 7 years dramatically, for the past 7 years, they've taken their sales from 1.2 billion to almost 2.6 billion. They must deal with that surge in demand and decrease in hazelnut supply and figure out what they want to do to mitigate that risk. Next, Cody will dive into our recommendation.
So really what we're seeing in Turkey is there's a lot of price reactivity. And if you want to look at Appendix F, I can follow along here. But essentially from 2007 to 2014, a 1% decrease in supply in Turkey of hazelnuts leads to a 1.3% increase of price. And that's absolutely noticeable in 2014, where we saw a 35% decrease in the quantity lead to a 97% increase in price. And we calculated in Appendix B that that additional raw material cost is $989 million just for that year alone. So what we really wanted to do was create some actions that Ferrero Group could potentially due to mitigate the speculation of the price changing. And we identified six different actions. So first is do nothing and adjust the price per unit, which obviously the customer would not like to, you know, make up for that cost. Do nothing and absorb the cost. We identified that as $989 million and some change. And you know, that's a lot every year that a poor frost occurs. That's gonna be a huge impact to the business. You could buy a supplier such as Molton. You could buy a direct competitor. You could create your own production facility by vertically integrating and compete with companies such as Molton. Or you could do a quasi-integration kind of scheme where you purchase a percentage of the production process, such as the creaming, and streamline that yourself. So we created this decision criteria matrix, and we identified four criterion, basically for these decisions. And this is on Appendix A, and you can see our weights and scores. But we identified our criterion as long-run cost impact, long-term risk, customer perception, and supply chain efficiency. So these are the total scores for each action and each criterion. And on the right here are the total scores that we identified. And as you can see, purchasing Molton is the highest score at about 4.2, max score is 5. So with that, we recommend that Ferrero Group purchases Molton for $456 million for $940,000 USD. And we arrived at that number by looking at food processing industry benchmarks for profit margin and enterprise valuation multiples. And we took that data from New York University and we applied it to the $500 million turnover provided via the case that Molton makes every single year. And that's how we arrived at that number, and we're very confident with that. Next, I will hand it off to Cal, who will further justify our recommendation.
So we decided to drill deeper into three of our main criteria to justify purchasing Molton. The first one is the long-term cost of implementation cost of purchasing a supplier. The first and most obvious advantage to that is that you get your supplies at cost. There's nobody in this industry that's currently integrated from start to end. So by backward integrating, you can gain margin on a commodity. And in an industry like that, wherever you can add value, it'll be helpful. In addition to adding your input costs, you have the elimination of the speculators. As you can see in the case, a lot of the fluctuation has been potentially pegged on people that are going in and trying to hedge these outcomes. And by backward integrating, you're going to be closer to the raw material. And the closer you are to the raw material, the less you have to rely on a speculator. And as a result of that, you'll have a more accurate and transparent forecast, as well as a longer forecast horizon. And once you get that, you can have lower inventory levels across the board, as well as have more accurate purchasing data, as well as pricing data. And the next piece that we looked at was the long-term risk coverage of purchasing a supplier. Now, as Cody mentioned, the reactionary pricing is mostly due to the fluctuation in Turkey. So from that first graph, a majority of the price change happens when a production change comes out of Turkey. What we did was couple that with another stat with the coefficient of variation of the production of hazelnuts across the world. That's the graph on the right. And as you can see, the hazelnuts coming out of Turkey have a 50% more variability than anywhere else in the world. So when you couple these two together, the most simplified version is that not only is Turkey causing the price change, they also have the most volume fluctuation. By backward integrating, you can hedge that risk and cover the most variable part of your process. And the last piece that we looked at was the supply chain efficiency of backward integrating. The first would be a decreased transaction cost. Once you own a supplier, all of your transaction costs become internal. In addition to that, you have faster communication from end to end. There's nobody in the industry that can talk from a shelf all the way back to a raw producer. And as a result, you can order faster, get to market faster, and react faster. In addition to that, you'll have better visibility. This ties into the previous slide, where the more that you know, you can substitute knowledge for inventory. And as a result, you should be able to be the most competitive in the industry with your inventory levels. And lastly, you'll have more accurate data, which is playing on the back of that. Because the more you know, the better you can manage it, and the better you can. So next, I'll pass it off to Alex, who will cover the implementation roadmap of our suggestion.
Perfect. Thanks, Cal. Now, if you would like to follow along in Appendix G, this will have a more detailed timeline that we will follow. So just to give some brief background, the numbers January 15 and July 15, those are in years. So that's January 2015, July 2015. So as you can see, this goes all the way to January of 2018. So we expect this implementation to take a total of 3 years. Now, I won't go through every single step, but I'll hit on the key points that we think are most important. So starting with number two, conducting a risk assessment and feasibility analysis. We want to make sure we know what we're getting into before we acquire the Olthon Group. Make sure we know their strengths, whatever weaknesses they have, whatever debts, and so forth. Next, on step number four, as we came to the previous number of 459 million, we'd like to get as close or cheaper if possible when we negotiate that price. Next, step number six, we know when it comes to M&A and also when Fortune 500 companies are trying to implement their ERP systems, whether it be SAP, it takes a long time and a lot of preparation. Now, Olthon is a lot smaller than a lot of these big systems, so we thought that 6 months would be adequate enough planning for this situation. And in step number eight, we have set up a 1 year timeline for implementing all these systems and tools across Olthon and its factories. Lastly, step number 10, which is where we would basically record and review every step of our process to make sure we know what we were doing at that time and we could better prepare ourselves if the Ferrero Group were ever to acquire another company in the future. Next, John will further dive further into our considerations.
Thanks, Alex. So 3 years down the line after we've acquired Olthon, we now have this new business venture opportunity that we can pursue if we choose to do so. So that opportunity is applying Olthon's business model to the fragmented Italian hazelnut market. And so Olthon's specialty, and they are expertise as the world leader in 25% of the entire hazelnut production, is sourcing from thousands of different local farmers and consolidating that and then moving that inventory to a giant food processor like Ferrero. So we figured, if they have this technology, we can use it in a new market potentially down the line if it proves to be profitable. And why Italy? Well, there's a growing trend of farmers shifting from vineyards to hazelnut farming. This is because with the, as Alex had mentioned, new telesales have doubled in the past decade. Confectionery companies are like looking more into sourcing hazelnuts, and it's becoming much more of a stable industry, and there's more intense demand. And Italy is a source of world-class premium hazelnuts. That's a result of their warm summers and wet winters. And if we do use Italy as well as Turkey, we're diversifying our sources of production. So we're being able to hedge against that risk that has affected us this year and back in 2011. Our whole Old Town also accounts for, like I said, 25% of total hazelnut production. So they know what practices work best in the industry, how to negotiate with local farmers, and so on. So we can apply those practices to a very fragmented Italian market and source from multiple small company growers, just as they do in Turkey. And lastly, there are four existing Ferrero production plants, and two of them are within an hour of over two-thirds of Italy's entire hazelnut production. So it wouldn't be too logistically challenging to source from those small farmers to one central location where it is then processed by Ferrero, a giant food processor, just as Old Town does in Turkey. So in conclusion, we believe that using Old Town as a short-term investment to cover costs, as well as hedge some of that risk, and then also opening up long-term business venture possibilities of implementing its technology in new markets, proves that acquiring Old Town is the best option for us. And with that, we'd like to thank you for your time and open it up for question and answer.
So just to be clear, the recommendation is acquire Old Town. You guys have valued them at roughly a $500 million. But then expand into Italy?
Yeah, if it proves to be viable. So there's trends showing that the industry is booming, and after 3 years we find that that remains to be true, then we look into that as like the next thing on the docket.
Okay, so primary step one in the recommendation is complete the acquisition.
Right, yes.
Step two is look at other geographies, Italy being the one you're calling.
It's kind of like a next step.
It's opening up new.
Not start the implementation like parallel with this, but like continue.
Is there a connection? Is there some kind of a value that you see in the Italy expansion that offsets the cost of a $500 million investment? Or
yeah, so Italy is the second largest producer, and they have 8% of the entire world's population. So we thought Italy would be a great market. Currently, Ferrero does source from there, but not too much, and it's from all different small suppliers. So if we can get a large volume of sourcing from that country, like we're still very reliant on Turkey, but it would give us a little bit more of like balancing that risk, so we're not 100% dependent on Turkey.
And the hazelnuts in Italy are considered to be more of a premium, so those are used more in their like premium chocolate brands as well, instead of sourcing those from Turkey, which go in more so Nutella and some of the more basic products. So it's more of a premium market that we want to penetrate.
So two questions. Does Nutella need that premium hazelnut in Italy? And does Italy, so hazelnut growing is increasing in Italy. Does Italy have the manufacturing processing capacity to handle the growth, or are we going to have to invest in that as well if we start sourcing more from Italy?
Yeah, so I can answer that. Currently, Ferrero produces Nutella in Italy in two different plants, and that's where the more they have acquired, that's where they keep bringing in that inventory to. So, I mean, I'm guessing with future development, they might have to expand that capacity, but they do use premium Italian hazelnuts in the Italian-produced Nutella factories, and they also produce in Turkey Nutella, but that they don't use the premium hazelnuts.
I can add on to that. Due to the fact that they have such a large market share, I believe that's also in the appendix case that we were given, they have approximately 65% of the total market share. So if they were to even create a specific niche brand of their own premium hazelnuts and they could sell that to that upper niche class, that would also be a better possibility for them instead of just putting that into their normal Nutella product.
Keep in mind, it's not just Nutella that they sell, they have their premium chocolate brands as well that those hazelnuts will go into.
I really like the fact that you went through a decision matrix, and I was trying to digest the weighting that you did, but either way, it's a big dollar to spend, and I'm curious if I feel like part of the weight should be we're going to spend this but get this return. And I'm not seeing, unless it's, I mean, you guys did a great job of adding a lot of pennies, I just had to flip through. Is there information on how we're going to obtain that return?
So, yeah, the ideal buyback period to pay this back is 5 years. We don't have the financial, like, the spreadsheet on there, but they don't have enough cash on hand to buy it in 100% cash, so you would have to leverage it to purchase it. But we did some more back-of-the-napkin calculations, and it is, you can pay it off in 5 years due to the increased margins from backward integrating, as well as the product growth.
Based off their 2014 earnings report, where we saw they had about approximately $230 million in cash on hand. So we would be able to apply for loans or due to other assets to make that large investment.
And keep in mind that we're doing this to avoid the potential almost $1 billion cost increase in materials from speculation fluctuation in that market. So we're avoiding
the cost of waste.
Yeah, it's kind of a two-sided.
As well as intangible assets if they do decide to implement the technology in other markets.
Can you explain a little bit more about the elimination of trade speculation, if that is such a key part of your financial assessment?
Yeah, I can speak on that. So it is, like I said, it is just that it's a lot of speculation. But there's an appendix in the case that talks about how there's kind of two differing points of view in terms of who's actually deciding on what the crop's going to look like. There seems to be kind of two camps. One is the farmers are underestimating the frost to jack up the price right now, or the speculators are underestimating the potential outcome to jack up the price right now. And I think there's a sentence near the end of it that says we're just going to have to wait and see until the actual crop comes out to see what the price is. But there is a note in here that the closer you are to the actual source, the less credible a speculator would be with these more fluctuating accusations. So you essentially give them less time to speculate and less leeway to speculate. And as a result, you can lock in your hazelnut contracts earlier, and that should drop your input price.
And a supplier like Olton is one of those speculators technically, because we're purchasing from them. So if we own them, we essentially can remove some of that speculation.
I'm looking at the decision matrix as well. If we said we just didn't have the capital, or for whatever reason we don't know that an acquisition makes sense, is there anything else that you considered as an option that you would call out, or in your analysis is this the one option that you see as viable and nothing else would make sense?
So I guess I can speak to that. You're right. It is a larger capital investment. One of the other ones we considered was like integrating yourself, but it didn't take that long to figure out that it's going to actually be a lot more expensive and take a lot longer to do. This one's really challenging because when 75% of the output is coming from one country, we kind of took the approach of there's not, even if Ferrero bought 100% outside of Turkey, there's not enough produced outside of Turkey to fill their demand. So we took the approach of, if you have to play in Turkey, why not win? Because it's not possible to supply it from outside. So if they really didn't have the money to do it, that's something that would be decided, but it would be with the assumption that next year we will be back in Turkey in some capacity, whether we're purchasing it, and if they're comfortable with taking that potential frost loss again with speculation, then that would have to be built into it.
We kind of went into this with the cost avoidance strategy kind of mentality, and if you look at the decision criteria, the first two do nothing, obviously don't remove any speculation. Purchasing Olton would have hopefully some effect. Buying direct competition would increase your market share and buying power, but it really wouldn't remove the speculation. Creating your own hazelnut production facilities would, but you'd have to create that relationship with farmers. And then the quasi-integration also really wouldn't, because you'd still have to purchase from a hazelnut supplier to streamline that process. So we kind of identified purchasing Olton or a supplier, and or you know, integrating ourselves, and we chose that purchasing in a company that has, you know, those core competencies to be the best viable option.
Talk a little bit about, you have your slide on long-term risk coverage. How does acquiring Olton help reduce risk when the majority of the risk is driven from weather events that are out of our control?
Yeah, so the way I guess I would approach it is, yeah, you can't control the weather, you can't control what's output, like what's coming from that. But from our perspective, the further you are away from that source, the more amplified those issues become. And the closer you are to that source, the more you can cut off where people are gonna be looking to capitalize on that. And basically, we know that if there's frost, it's gonna hurt everybody. It's just the closer we are to the source, it's gonna hurt us less.
All right.
Anything else?
Thank you.
Thank you
guys
for
your time.
Thank you.